In the 1940s, on the northwestern coast of the United States, it only took 40 mile per hour winds to cause the Tacoma Narrows Bridge to sway and twist. Although it was designed to withstand much more, complicated and rare circumstances caused the bridge to tear itself apart. America, the land of opportunity, has always been at the forefront of progress. Across its 50 states, the nation has enjoyed decades of successful development. After the devastating effects of the Wall Street crash of 1929, the late 1930s and early 1940s saw the steady resurgence of the wounded economy. The country began to construct a new breed of magnificent skyscrapers, bridges, railroads, and dams to impress the world.
Recognizing the importance of good highways and roads, all levels of government, from county to federal, spend over $3 billion a year on the nation's highway system.
In 1937, the iconic Golden Gate Bridge opened in San Francisco, becoming at the time the longest suspension bridge in the world.
The construction of the Golden Gate started in January 1933, and it was opened on May 1937, so it took 4 years and 4 months.
1 year later, nearly 800 miles north in Washington state, construction began on a bridge to connect the city of Tacoma with the Kitsap Peninsula. It would take the threat of war for the US government to finally approve funding for the bridge. As Japan invaded China, and the world saw the rise of Nazi Germany under Adolf Hitler, US President Franklin D. Roosevelt began quietly strengthening the US military, funding rearmament, but at the same time spending millions of dollars on roads, dams, and bridges. On June 23, 1938, the Tacoma Narrows Bridge was finally approved.
A bridge had been proposed since the 1880s, but according to local papers at the time, the reason it finally got the go-ahead was a military necessity to link the McChord Airfield on the Tacoma side with the Puget Sound Naval Base on the Kitsap Peninsula.
This was a period of important financial constraints because the country was moving into an international war. There was the Depression. And the moment the federal agency awarded the grant for the construction of the bridge, it actually awarded for half the price, more or less, of what the initial cost indicated. And this came also with a requirement to hire some specific engineers, including Leon Mossif.
Leon Mossif was a bridge engineer, graduating from Columbia University in 1895.
The original design was a pretty conventional suspension bridge.
The original bridge was designed by a state engineer.
Leon was brought in from New York City, and his proposal was a much more streamlined bridge, which not only looked more elegant, but cost about half the amount because of the reduced amount of steel being used.
Although the state originally estimated the cost of the bridge at $11 million, engineers from the East Coast working with Mossif claimed they could make it for less and were awarded $6.4 million.
It was famously nicknamed Galloping Gertie by the construction workers, I believe.
Movement was felt during the construction of the bridge that caused concern, and various strategies were used to try and reduce this motion, but none of them were effective.
Although the bridge was designed to withstand winds of up to 120 miles per hour, engineers installed four buffers at the towers to act as shock absorbers. They didn't appear to make any improvement, but the bridge was deemed safe. On the 1st of July 1940, Tacoma Narrows Bridge was opened as the third largest suspension bridge in the world, covering 5,900 feet with a main span of 2,800. Beaten only by New York City's George Washington Bridge and San Francisco's Golden Gate.
At nation hailed the opening of the new $6.5 million Tacoma Narrows Bridge over Puget Sound. Governor Clarence Martin officiated at the dedication and was the first over the new mile-long shortcut to the Olympic Peninsula.
The National Guard fired a 19-gun salute, and 7,000 people joined the governor to marvel at the structure.
What an engineering marvel it seemed.
2,000 cars crossed on opening day alone. In a few months, over 250,000 cars used the bridge. Although structurally sound, the bridge still moved in the wind, with the roadway rising and falling up to 5 feet. Some motorists stopped using the bridge. Others flocked to it to experience the waves for themselves.
Before the bridge was built, to travel from Tacoma to the Kitsap Peninsula was a long journey taking 2.5 hours. Now it would only be 11 minutes.
In the early hours of the 7th of November, 1940, high winds blew through the Narrows.
Stiff winds blowing up Puget Sound caused it to sway and finally to weave and twist, as you see here in these amazing pictures taken at risk of life.
At 10 a.m., Leonard Coatsworth was the last person to cross before highway officials and state police closed the bridge.
I saw the Narrows Bridge die today, and only by the grace of God escaped dying with it. I drove on the bridge and started to cross. In the car with me was my daughter's cocker spaniel, Tubby.
A reporter deserted his car on the bridge and crawled back to safety as the great roadway, like a pendulum of doom, swayed and twisted in its death agony.
Just as I drove past the towers, the bridge began to sway violently from side to side. Before I realized it, the tilt became so violent that I lost control of the car. I jammed on the brakes and got out, only to be thrown onto my face against the curb. Around me, I could hear concrete cracking. I started back to the car to get the dog, but was thrown before I could reach it.
He abandoned his car with a pet dog inside, the only life lost in the disaster.
The bridge was breaking up, and my only hope was to get back to shore.
The giant cables are under stupendous strain.
I crawled 500 yards or more to the towers. My knees were raw and bleeding, my hands bruised and swollen from gripping the concrete curb. Safely back at the toll plaza, I saw the bridge in its final collapse and saw my car plunge into the Narrows.
It literally shook itself to pieces.
There it goes! The most sensational scene filmed since the Hindenburg disaster. It seems like a bad dream. It's hard to believe.
With real tragedy, disaster, and blasted dreams all around me, I believe that right at this minute what appalls me most is that within a few hours, I must tell my daughter that her dog is dead when I might have saved him.
By 6 a.m. the following morning, the ferry service that had been rendered almost obsolete by the bridge resumed service for Cross Narrows travelers. The initial engineers were quick to speak out. They blamed the lack of funding and the East Coast engineers and designs that were forced upon them by the moneylenders. Legal and insurance issues meant 9 months later, no plans to replace or repair the bridge had been agreed. The salvage operation began immediately and lasted nearly 2 years, continuing until May 1943. Two review boards were appointed and decided the bridge would need to be dismantled, with an entirely new structure built in its place. On December 7, 1941, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. One day later, the United States joined World War II. A shortage of material and labor meant that it was almost 10 years before a replacement bridge was opened in 1953. Nearly 60 years later, in 2007, a second bridge opened. By 2020, it's estimated to carry nearly 50 million vehicles per year.